We started this one back in 2014, and for some reason we didn't get to finish it. And so tonight I'm going to be refreshing you a little bit on it, but at the same time adding just a wee bit more so we can all enjoy this. And do not be surprised if you have to take part in an unusual way tonight. Okay? All right. We're talking about the Holy Spirit. Oops. Here I go tearing up the mics now. It starts off with, in the beginning, God created creating the heavens and the earth. When the earth was astonishingly empty, with darkness upon the surface of the deep, and the divine presence hovered upon the surface of the waters, God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. Now, what or who is he? And when I say he, I am speaking of the Holy Spirit. Questions have been raised for many, many years, and there's been no definitive answer except for the fact that he is the Almighty God. We can speculate of his appearing and his miracles, his speaking and his unusual approach to things, but when all of the scrutiny and overworking of the idea of a divine being is over, it is still the Holy Lord God we are speaking of. And I'm going to stop there because I want you to listen to this song. I know most of you know it when you hear it. Okay, Randolph. The Holy Spirit is a very powerful, powerful being. God is transcendent. And what I mean by that is that he cannot be counted as nature or creation because he created everything. He is the creator and therefore not definable by length or width of height or time. There's just no measuring him. Our minds cannot even control or even think of what he's like, what the Holy Spirit is like. We know that a little bit of him lives in each one of us, and yet there's still so much more of him. In our little minds, we figure being something like this, he has to be his own God. You know, if there's a moon, there's got to be a moon God. The sun, there's got to be a sun God, because we can't see so much of one God controlling everything. We just can't. But instead of wasting time and trying to explain things to us so that we can understand it, what we need to do is learn how to accept it and let him control us. It doesn't mean that he has not given us willpower, but he has. But everything he does for our own good. And by the way, he still controls everything. So the Holy Spirit is a divine being, and he is an entity of the Godhead. He is not a separate God from the Almighty God. There are many who would like to say that, but that's not what he is. He's not separate from the Godhead, okay? But he is a part of that majestic being who sits on the throne and calls out to us from heaven. His purpose is to draw us back to the Lord, and he does it in so many unique ways that it just is overpowering to your mind to see him work, okay? He's beautiful and powerful as the God himself he is, but he's doing that through his Holy Spirit. He instructs us and he directs us. The Holy Spirit is present in the Bible from the book of Genesis. The first verse we read for you was from Genesis 1, 1 and 2. And depending on the translation that you read, it will be saying the Spirit of God moved, or the divine presence. And that's what it is. The divine presence is the Spirit of God. So what is he to you? Is he a person or what? Well, I give you an example in here. And I said, think of him as a close friend that has stood by your side through the best and the worst of circumstances, always available to you, even if you did not want them in your presence. No matter what, that friend will never abandon you. They will always say, I'm here for you if you need me. Some may say that there are not people like that anymore, but there are many of them who are overlooked and sometimes considered bothersome because we say they're just too clingy and they don't give us any space to breathe. They are there for a purpose, and that purpose is to nudge us gently and make us look at ourselves in a different light. We see, when we look at ourselves sometimes, we see failure, but that person will look at us and say, try again. We see the incomplete person, and they say success as the very end. We see a person who's so small compared to the rest of the world, but they see a person of greatness paving a way for the world to become righteous. This friend will stand up for us, will pray for us, interceding on our behalf, giving us courage to become power in the sight of God. They can see what God has given us when we cannot understand or want to understand. We run from our future, and they will help to reroute our course so that we will end up in a place where God wants us to be. This friend will allow us to complain, cry, whine, and then tell us to get up and brush off the dust off the old self and go on with the new. This friend is a guide, always navigating the waters of life for you. No matter how harsh you treat them, it is almost impossible to make them walk away from you. This is called unconditional love. And this is the Holy Spirit, your best friend and confidant. Trust him. Recognizing the Holy Spirit. And recognizing the Holy Spirit is something awesome in the Bible. I just love reading about it. Because when you're reading it, you want to shout, you want to cry, you want to do all kinds of stuff. Okay? But you have to recognize him through what he is and how he appears to you. And what he recognizes, he comes as a symbol. in a number of ways. Our symbol is a representation of something different from itself. And the word is a combination of two words, sin, meaning together, and balin, meaning to throw together, meaning to throw. So in other words, it means something that is thrown together. There are two languages of the Bible. Two languages of the Bible. Listen to what I'm saying. Two languages of the Bible. The language of creation is the first three chapters in the Bible. And from there is the language of redemption. Okay? Do we understand that? All right. So our sin in the garden brought about that change. It was a dilemma when man chose disobedience over obedience. So now it changes us from creation to the wonderful time in the beautiful garden where we had nothing but the best of everything to a need for redemption. And that's what that is. So a symbol is a language of creation, which becomes a language of the symbol, and that in turn becomes the language of redemption. Kind of crazy, I know. But so the Lord spoke in symbols quite often. He spoke in symbols to his prophets. And that's why people would look at him sometimes. Even Jesus spoke in parables, which were symbols. And he sometimes confused you as to what was going on, what was being said. But these examples of symbols come from different kingdoms. First of all, from the mineral, vegetable, animal, and human realm. Of the mineral kingdom, we got gold, silver, and brass, precious stones, and et cetera. Vegetable kingdom, fine linen made from flax, acacia wood, olive oil, spices, and et cetera. Animal kingdom, goat's hair, ram's skins, horns, sheep, and et cetera. And human kingdom, men and women used by God, the spiritual kingdom, God himself, the tabernacle, water, and et cetera. Now let's look at somehow he used some of these. The wind and nature. The wind, the symbol of divine control of creation. Controlling the power of the wind set in motion the building agents needed to create a universe. Just as we said with Genesis 1 and 2 is where we start with the power of the wind. Okay? The King James Version, as I said earlier, said the Spirit moved. The Hebrew version of the Bible said the divine presence moved. But all of them mean the Spirit, which is the Ruach. This is the way that it's pronounced in Hebrew, meaning wind or breath of God. Okay. From this breath comes the creation in motion, even to this present day. His power is still going on. It's still in the wind. He's controlling everything. He determines which way and how far things will go for us. He controls it. Have you ever been present when the storm was brewing? And you feel, all of a sudden the wind seems to stop blowing. When I was growing up, we would be outside in the shade, no air conditioning. My mother didn't believe in it. And we're sitting outside and so enjoying this nice cool breeze. All of a sudden it would stop. And all of the adults said, it's getting ready to storm. Let's go inside. And we're looking around like, you know how kids are. We want to stay outside and play. What do you mean it's going to storm? And they knew by the time we got into the house and got everything closed down, the windows closed down, which was awful in the summertime in Florida. Lord have mercy. And then the storm would come by the time you got inside. And you said, wow, that is awesome. But those storms sometimes were very, very powerful. The wind was powerful. It wasn't just a wind, but it was a wind who could take your roof off the house, could uproot trees and so forth. And we had one of those storms almost every afternoon, between like 1 or so, 1, 2, 3 o'clock in the afternoon. In Florida right now, you still get them. But the nature of it was the wind was doing something special. Wind is always changing things. You can't stay constant. You can't be sedentary when there's wind around because of something has got to change. And that's exactly what would happen. Even the air would be cleaner. It was the most beautiful thing to smell the air after a rainstorm, after the wind had come through. And you would just sit there and go, wow, this smells so good. The smell that came from the ground. And then there would be a nice breeze that would be blowing on you, and you want to just stay in it and just soak it. That's the way the Holy Spirit works on us too. So the nature of the wind is very powerful. It can be frightening and for those of us who don't understand it, and it can be enjoyable for those who love it. That's why I said, when you're dealing with the Holy Spirit, there are things that it does that will just wipe you out. And here it is with the wind. You are in his presence. You're standing in the presence of the Lord. He uses his breath to change things. The wind always changes things. It can be powerful enough to dry up riverbeds. And we see that's going to happen. We saw it in the book of Ezekiel, and we see it in the book of Revelation, when the wind is going to dry up the riverbeds, the Euphrates River. So all of those armies that want to come against Israel and get their butts beat are going to try to cross there. Okay? We saw the wind part the Red Sea so the children of Israel could walk across on dry land. What a marvelous thing that was might have been. Can you imagine standing on one side of the water and watching that water part from the wind of God? And then to put your foot down and you're not stepping in mud, you're stepping on dry land in the middle of the water. How powerful is the wind? That's the Holy Spirit. Now the wind in man. We speak about nature and how the wind plays a part in the changes of the planet and the universe, but it also plays a part in man. Man became a living soul because the Lord blew breath into him. The name Adam means to come from the dirt, from the ground, and is pronounced Adam or Adama in the Hebrew. Science sometimes sees man just as another primate. He calls him superior primate of the others, but they don't think of us as having that much more intelligence than an ape. But man is a unique creature. He is a miracle of creation in that he is of nature and he is also spirit. He's not just one part or the other. Man was given a soul, the word nefesh, or neshama, or the Hebrew terms used for that. And man became a living being because God blew into him. He is a prototype that cannot be copied. No matter what science does, whatever he tries to use a man to make another man, he's still got to go back to the source to try to make it. And he still just can't do it. He can't do it. If every human being has a living soul and a portion of God that believes in him. Clement, one of the fathers of the early church, wrote that the Lord God knows us and our thoughts and our desires because he's one who has placed the soul within us. So long as God's breath remains within us, we are alive, is what he's saying. So we are different from all other creatures. You know, we are a hybrid. Yeah, that's what we are. When you try to put us in one category or the other, we just don't fit. So we are a hybrid of both. We're part physical, biological, and other part spiritual world. On one hand, we are physical beings because we can see ourselves and we can touch each other. But at the same time, when you say, well, where's your spirit? You can't put your hand on it. That's divine. And that's where the Lord wants it. All right? We're different from animals. We have a soul. They do not. They're just obedient creatures. But the Lord gave us free will. Gave us a beautiful place to live. And he's going to take us to his eternal home as long as we stay with him. We know that the wind can change things because he did with Elijah. Elijah got caught up in a whirlwind. Can you imagine the sight of that? We can only believe what we've read, but can you imagine the sight of a man who the Lord saw to be so holy and so precious to him that he wouldn't even let him die? He'd just sweep down and pick him up in the wind. Wow. Wow. Another change coming. The blowing of the wind in the valley of dry bones in the book of Ezekiel. Oh my gosh. You know, the role that they said that place was, where the valley of the dry bones was the place where they used to take the Israelites who died. And they wouldn't bury them. They'd just take them and toss them out there. It was just a big area filled with rotting bodies. Animals would come along and take parts of their bodies away and everything. But the Lord tells Ezekiel to go and prophesy over those dry bones. And he does. The bones start coming together and everything. Can you imagine the sound of those bones coming together from all over that field? Even those bones that had been carried away. But still nothing changed yet until the wind came. The wind came. And when the wind came, it blew everything into place where it should have been. What a noise, what a great noise that must have been. Now, we're going to do some things here with sound. And John, I need for you to go and take your place. And like I told you, you're going to do a little something different today. Okay? Okay. All right. Thank you. So be prepared to do some stuff. Okay? It said, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues as of fire, and it set upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now, how do we experience the Holy Spirit through sound? It comes in music. It comes in whispers, the spoken word, instrument, wind, and the rumbling of thunder. Make sure you got my thunder ready now. Okay. All right. It takes being quiet at times to hear the sound that the Lord sends as he releases his power on us to do his will. So making noise and not listening to his voice when he speaks, but if we were to listen, we would hear the most beautiful sound in the universe. And we're going to try a little bit of all of this in a minute here. So when you are down in the dumps and you feel that you just cannot do anymore and everything is going against you, sometimes you will hear the rustle of leaves outside. Okay? When you do, listen to the scripture, because there's a scripture for everything practically. And it says, for you shall go out with joy and be led forth with peace. The mountains and the hills shall break forth before you into singing. And all of the trees of the field will do what? Clap their hands. Sit and listen to them early in the morning. You know, we get so busy in the morning that we don't hear anything. We're just trying to get ready to go somewhere. But if the wind is blowing, it's exactly what it sounds like. A group of people, a whole audience out there clapping their hands when it's going through the trees. It is an awesome sound. That's the Holy Spirit at work. Can you imagine the sound of creation forming? Can you imagine it breaking the sound barrier when things started to move? Can you imagine how the world was starting to behave? A volcano, seeing the power of the volcano, and you hear all this rumbling coming up out of the earth, the lava and all of this stuff, and where was it going to stop? The wind had to stop it, the sound of it. There was a sound of the water separating itself from land. Can you imagine that? What was the sound separating day and night? We don't know, but it has to be beautiful. What was the sound of earth being formed and shaped into the sphere that it is? We see flashes of lightning all the time. Don't pay attention to it, Ubi. But if you would listen, after you see that lightning, what comes afterwards? Yes, okay? But by the time man was placed on the earth and all the chaos had ceased, the Lord put him in a place of incredible beauty and stability. The earth was stable. Okay. Now, the sounds are like music to us. So listen to the human voice. Anyone who would like to just read a scripture or recite one, just recite a verse. Come on. I know you know at least one verse. Somebody. Yes. Amen. It's good. I want a verse, though. You naughty rascal. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. That is so pleasing to us.
The Lord shall send from heaven with a shout.
Yes.
God, the archangel, the dead Christ shall rise first, and the believers who are alive and remain shall be altogether forever.
Isn't that good news? Isn't that good news? The Spirit can move you through that. And then I want you to do this, sing for me, everybody. The hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on. Come on. Okay, so wait a minute. I know we can do better. Hallelujah. Just sing it through. That's all it's saying. All you got to say is hallelujah. Okay? Somebody give me a tune. Elder Robinson, can start us off. Okay, somebody. Thank you. Thank you. Everybody sing. Listen to that. Isn't that beautiful? When we all on one accord and in unity, it starts to move through you. Ah, that's beautiful. Ah, soothing too. The Holy Spirit can reach us through that sound. Because what are we doing? We're singing nothing but the highest praise to the Lord. Then the sound of silence. Because we can do that real good, silence. We do it all the time in church when we should be shouting. Okay? Amen. Amen. So I want everybody to be silent for about 30 seconds. I know. Okay, I'm going to let you off because most of you are about to choke. Okay. Now, I'm not going to blow the shofar tonight because we've heard enough of that for a while. But we got somebody up here who knows what to do when we hear the drum beat because we are listening to the rhythm of the heartbeat of God. Come on, John. Now, get out of your seats. Get up. Get up. All right, you're the army of God, so march around this church. Get moving. Come on. Take them back to their seats now. Take them back to their seats. All right. I know. Okay. Now, John, I want you to give me just the clashing of cymbals. Just make as much noise as you want to on the cymbals. Thank you. Hallelujah. Thank you so much, John. Amen. And normally, even the sound of strings, when we hear those playing, it evokes something in sound inside of us. It says something that in the scripture where Elisha, in order to prophesy, he had to hear music. Okay? Is he all right? Okay. So now, Randolph, you got my thunder? Okay.
We forgot to praise the Lord with loud sounding cymbals first.
Okay, all right. Okay. So now what happens when we hear thunder? The sound of thunder is in the voice of the Lord. Just keep playing it. Okay. The sound of thunder at Mount Sinai and on the road to Damascus. Those who were not ready to receive the gift of God heard the thunder only. more me. Whenever the Lord spoke to Moses in the wilderness, the children of Israel heard the rumbling of thunder and felt its presence. The sound of thunder heard today, not knowing who the Lord is speaking or saying to anyone. The sound of thunder preparing the heart to receive a blessing in the form of rain that comes to replenish the earth and the spirit of man. What is in the sound of the rain? The sound of rain hitting the ground, even the smell of the rain, invokes the Holy Spirit to enter. The hard rains that come and change the course of rivers and remove things, including man, from the place where he is comfortable, sometimes causing us to step up to where the Lord wants us, or we will sink. Okay, thank you. In the valley of the dry bones, through the eyes of Ezekiel, the Holy Spirit and sound combining to bring life into what was considered a valley of death. It is speculation, like we said before, that these bodies were dumped there to rot and the animals to feed on. But Ezekiel was told to prophesy to these bones, and prophesied he did, and what a great sound there was in that wilderness. A noise drawing the bones together and then finding its matching bone. Can you imagine the animals had taken parts of the bodies different places? And then they had to come back and find the body that it belonged to, okay? This is the idea of the Holy Spirit, how powerful it is. It can do all these things. And then he said, prophesy to the Spirit, prophesy, O Son of Man, and say to the Spirit, thus said the Lord God, come from the four directions, O Spirit, and blow into these slain people that they may come to life. And he said, and I prophesied as I had been commanded, and the Spirit entered them, and they came to life. They stood upon their feet, a very, very great legion. So sound is paramount to the receiving of the Holy Spirit. In the book of Acts 2, 1 through 4, the sound of the wind and the noise of those receiving the baptism was so great that it caught the attention of those on the outside. In Acts 4, 29 through 31, the group prayed for the infilling of the Holy Spirit, and the place shook. The sound and vibration of a mighty act taking place upon the people of God who were of one voice and one accord. Now let's move on to fire. Yes, the fire. I'm almost finished. I hope y'all can hang in here with me just a little bit longer. Okay. Fire is symbolic of the holiness of God. It's giving attention to his strength and power. Fire can be a dangerous thing. If left unattended, it can be very, very dangerous. And it can cause much, much damage. It holds extreme power, as is one of the two elements that the heavens were created from, fire and water. But in the hand of God, the fire had to be contained and shaped into a form that would be obedient to him. Today, we can't even hold on to a pot that's hot. Can you imagine the Lord putting a ball of fire in the sky and making it obey him so that we would have light? All right? Who would cause it to maintain the balance of heat and cold for the earth to make it habitable for mankind? But there is a fire that falls from heaven that is very different from the fire that causes destruction. It is the power of God, his holiness. It causes men to not be able to stand still in the presence of his eternal flame. This holiness is the Messiah. Fire also calls changes to take place, and sometimes the very destructive nature of man, of things, it helps to keep it all powerful. The extreme temperatures can produce beautiful things by tossing them into the fire. How many of you have seen a beautiful piece of pottery and you said, that is so awesome? Well, it came, its shape, it's everything that is holding it together. Even the paint on it, the glaze on it, came from a hot fire, all right? The fire separates the impure from the pure. Fire gives direction. When we see forest fires, poor firefighters out there trying their best to redirect a fire, and it doesn't want to go the direction they want to go. And sometimes they have to run for their lives, because they're trying to control something that only God can control, okay? and he has a reason for it. We think of it as, we see it as destruction. Oh, this has been burned and that has been burned. Look what the trees we've lost and all of that. And the Lord is cleaning the area. And everything that was burned becomes food for that place right there. And he gives us brand new growth, and it's beautiful growth. I remember when Mount St. Helens erupted, and people will say, oh my gosh, that will never grow again. And within a few months, they were looking at these little shoots coming up through that hard mass of stuff that they could hardly, they had to use a pick to break loose. And they were showing, these are growing. It's coming right through it. The Lord knows exactly what he's doing. We have to trust him. So when we are trying to put things in order, God is saying, back up, this is my territory, and I want you to see me in action. So sometimes we reach out to him, thinking we got all the answers. Lord, you just move over, I'll take care of this. And he says, no, you move over, and I'll show you what I can do. The destruction of the fire can cause many devastation for many. It can destroy homes and everything else. But if you trust in God, the life that comes afterwards is true if you have faith. So the burning can control your destiny. For instance, the bush that burned but was not consumed was a real phenomenon in Moses' time. And it would be for us too, because it is not something that we might see in our lifetime, especially if the bush talked. Most of us would be gone, okay? The burning bush was the presence of God speaking to Moses, redirecting him. That friend that we were talking about earlier, who when you decide you want to go one direction, he will come back and redirect you. Moses thought he was safe out there in the wilderness, counting on Jethro's sheep and everything. But the Lord says, no, it's time for you to go back and go to work. This is why I saved you. You were supposed to be dead. But instead, the person who wanted to kill you, I brought you back to his house and raised you in there. It raised you to be a leader, give you the finest of everything, because one day you had to take your people home. So fire, that burning bush, changed the course of everything for Moses. And he worked with those people for 40 years to get them back to home, the place where the Lord had promised them. Now, poor Moses, if he had to deal with us today. Oh my gosh. All right? He moved over 1 million people. But we'd have to have the World Wide Web. We'd have to have our GPS. We'd have to know where we're going to stop, what kind of hotels we're going to stay in. And we cannot eat manna every day. No way we can eat the same thing every day. Uh-uh. We got to be somewhere where we can have a variety of hotels. Now, those little huts in the desert, those little temporary things, okay, they were cute for the first day or so. Okay, sleeping on the ground and everything, that was fun. But where's the mattress and the air conditioning and fresh water? You did not expect us to ride donkeys and camels. I know you didn't. How much is a gas gonna cost? Well, you think about it, that's what we are used to. And can you see us trying to leave Egypt? And Moses said, just be quiet, I'm going to get you there. No, you're not. You're taking us to die. No, yes. But we see the Holy Spirit was so special. He was so kind to the children of Israel. And he protected them so well, even in their desert. Because as marauders tried to come up on them, they saw something so beautiful, and it scared the daylights out of them. They saw this huge ball of fire that was keeping them going all night. There was their night light. And can you imagine looking down from a mountain in the desert where you got very little wood, and you have to scrape up just enough, try to get a little bit of a fire. And these people out there, you don't even see wood anywhere, and they got this massive fire going. That was the Holy Spirit taking care of them. Anybody in their right mind would leave them alone, Because how in the world can you have a fire like that with no wood? Moses spoke to the people, and he had to remind them of something. You have something so great that you can always look back on. And I'm telling you, you have something that you can tell your children and your children's children and so forth. And this is what he asked them. He asked them questions like this. Has there ever been anything like this great thing or anything like it been heard? Has the people ever heard the voice of God speaking from the midst of the fire as you have heard and survived? Or has any God ever miraculously come to take for himself a nation from amidst the nations with challenges, with signs, and with wonders, and with war, and with a strong hand, and with an outstretched arm, and with greatly awesome deeds, such as everything that the Lord your God did for you in Egypt before your eyes? You have that been shown in order to know that the Lord, he is God. There is none beside him. Because he showed them so many wonderful things. He led them by fire. He brought them to Mount Horeb, which is Mount Sinai. And he lit the mountain, and it thundered and everything. And the people didn't understand what was going on. But the mountain was on fire, but it did not burn. Now, modern day people would know. If you go to near a mountain where there's rumbling and there's fireworks are coming out of it, you better get as far away from it as possible. Because when everything falls, it's going to land on you. But they didn't get singed, not one bit. As a matter of fact, Moses instructed them to go and bathe. Prepare yourself, because the Lord is going to speak. Okay? We see fire again with Elijah, because here are these gods of Baal. And these men are going to go out there and they're going to challenge him. And they would say, most of us would say that Elijah took off, bit off a little bit more than he could chew. Because he's going to tell them, okay, you go make your God do this and I'll show you what mine can do. Then he tells them what all to do to the same altar that they had beat themselves, cut themselves, danced around and everything. And he even teased them, your God must be asleep somewhere. Or where is he? In the bathroom or whatever, something like that. I love that one. Yeah, me too. And then he tells them to do the impossible. Just load it up and pour water all over it. Put water in the trench all around it. Let's see what's going to happen. Then he called on those God. And the Lord sent came down in the fire of Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit came down and it just consumed everything that was on that altar. And he was a little bit thirsty too, so he lapped up all of the water that was in the trench. All right? That is the Holy Spirit. So the fire that descended from heaven came to wake us up and to show us the power of God. It is awesome. He came down to perform in the burning bush. He came down on the mountain, which was the first Pentecost. And he came down as a protector in the wilderness, as a divine heavenly light. He came down to consume evil on the altar of Baal. But the greatest interest came finally in the upper room. When he came down in the cloven tongues of fire and touched each man and woman filling that place, filling them all with the Holy Spirit. And then in fulfilling the prophecy of Joel. And Joel said, and it can come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. And that verse goes on and on and on. And you just have a wonderful time. Thank you for listening to me tonight. If you have any questions, let's talk now. If not, Pastor, here's your mic.
Are there any questions? This Sunday, I'm battling between now what is three messages. So just be praying for me. I want to really deal with the spirit realm probably over the next couple Sundays. And it's really what that, because look, we as people, we have a weird fascination with the spirit realm that we have got to be careful of. And demons are a real thing. But I think this Sunday, what I'm going to deal with is their role in blocking our access to heaven. And what is it, what's the problem when we pray and it feels like our prayers don't get past the ceiling? When we feel there's no presence, what's going on there? And what can we do to combat that? I think that's the big question I want to answer. And obviously we know sin is one of those things. You know, if there's sin in our lives, we got to get rid of it because it blocks. It creates a block between us and God. Unforgiveness, I believe, is another big block. So we're going to talk, I believe that's where I'm going to land on Sunday. And it's not very cowboy, but I'm just going to follow the Spirit of God. And then we'll see what happens. But I just believe that we can have breakthrough in our prayer and we can experience the presence of God every single day, every single moment. But when you feel that blockage, what is that blockage? And hopefully we can help you deal with that. Because I believe sometimes we all feel like we're praying and it's like, God, there doesn't seem anything going on between us. And how can we break through that? And how can we get to the point? Because I don't think God abandons his people. You know, and I'm not saying depending on feeling. Amen? But I do believe that there is something between you and God when we have that relationship that you know is there. And how can we break through that? So hopefully that'll help us out. Also, if you can help me on tomorrow, starting at 2, or Friday, starting at 2. We'll probably be here a little later on Friday because this one we'll be building everything. But tomorrow is when I'll be kind of bringing everything in and gathering all the stuff and getting it together. As you can see, the foyer is already a mess because we've brought in the hay and things. So if you can help me with that, especially in the building part on Friday, that'd be fantastic because I want to build a bank this year. We've got a jail, and then we also have the general store. So all of your help would be appreciated. If anybody has any like wood laying around your backyard and you can help, just bring it. We'll probably find a purpose for it. Any pallets or whatever, just bring them. Amen. I want to close out by playing that song again, Randolph, Spirit of the Living God. Can you get that ready? I'm asking everybody to stand. And let's just engage his presence. And let's try to press through all the junk, all the distractions, and all the things that try to hinder us from experiencing God's presence. And then as you feel released, you can go ahead and leave. Just don't forget your children. Amen. You got it ready, Randolph? All right.
Spirit of the living God, we only want to hear your
Please make sure that you begin now and every day to prepare yourself for what God wants to do in your life, and let that culminate on Sunday morning. I believe that the Sunday morning experience is really all about our preparation during the week. So many Christians see Sunday morning as a ticket that you punch in order to make God happy. And it's more about the extension of a relationship coming together through more than one person, that corporate anointing. And I just really want to see God's people begin to really prepare ourselves. I encourage you, listen to worship music every day. I listen to worship music almost all day every day. My wife came into sanctuary and music was blaring. How do you study with that music so loud? And it's just, music just does something. And it opens something up. It's like that sound you were talking about earlier. So prepare yourself, get yourself ready, and just every day, contact presence of God. Amen. God bless. See you on Sunday.